Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, let's get on our feet and give God praise this morning. He's worthy. He's worthy. It's time to worship. It's time to praise. In the name of our God. Come on, put those hands together and give God glory. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm trading my sorrows for the joy of the Lord. How many of you have the joy of the Lord this morning? I wouldn't take nothing from a journey now. I've got the joy of the Lord, and the joy of the Lord is my strength. Wonderful name. In the name of Jesus, we have the victory. Anybody got a victory this morning? Anybody got the victory this morning?
Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
season because you got victory. Hallelujah. Yeah. Glory be to Jesus. We praise his name this morning. We got victory. Hallelujah. Somebody lift your voice and just shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. Oh, bless his wonderful name. And the one thing that we ought to take notice in the name of Jesus is not in our name. It's not because of who we are or what we have done. We can't add anything or take anything away from it, because it's all wrapped up in who Jesus is and what he's done on our behalf. Hallelujah. No goodness of our own. Hallelujah. It's all because of Jesus. God and God alone. Hallelujah. That's why he's worthy right now. That's why he's worthy right now. Because he's done it all. He provided it all. Hallelujah. And we praise you, Lord God. We give you glory in the house this morning. For who you are and the wonderful things that you have done. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Come on, just lift up holy hands and just worship the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Just give him the honor that's due his name. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Glory. Oh, how I love Jesus. Bless your name, bless your name. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Help me say. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Savior, 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 Savior. Savior, Savior, Savior. Savior, Savior, Savior. Call him Jesus, 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 Jesus. Savior, 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 Savior. Savior, Savior, Savior. Savior, Savior, Savior. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He's my healer. Healer, healer, healer. Yes, he is. Healer, healer, healer. Oh, healer, healer, healer. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Say it again, healer. Healer, healer, healer. Oh, healer, healer, healer. Healer, healer, healer. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Faithful, come on. Faithful, faithful, faithful. Come on, everybody, lift your voice and say, faithful, faithful, faithful. Yes, he is. Faithful, faithful, faithful. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Come on, he's faithful. Faithful, faithful, faithful. Yes, he is. Faithful, faithful, faithful. Oh, faithful, faithful, faithful. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Come on, say, I love him, love him, love him. Come on, if you love the Lord, say, I love him, love him, love him. Let's worship him. I love him, love him, love him. Oh, yes, I do. I love him, love him, love him. He's Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He's worthy, 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 worthy. Yes, he is worthy, worthy, worthy. He's worthy.
Worthy, worthy, worthy.
He's Jesus, 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 Jesus. Come on, he's worthy, 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 worthy. He's worthy, 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 worthy. Yes, he is worthy, worthy, worthy. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Now call his name. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Come on, if you love him, say, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Nobody like Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Come on and give God praise this morning. Give him glory. Give him honor. Give his name the praise. Come on, clap those hands and give God glory in this house. Hallelujah. 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 He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Come on, don't patty cake up in here. Give God praise. For the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We come to praise that name. We come to lift and exalt that name. No other name I know but the name of Jesus. He's worthy. Bless his name. Thank you, God. Bless your name, Jesus. Deacon Robinson is coming now to lead us in prayer, followed by the scripture, Pastor Lawson. Every heart pray.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Let us bow. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just come to you, Lord, humbly. Thank you. On our knees, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for such a great week. Lord, you've been so good to us. Things we've seen, things we haven't even seen. Lord, thank you for bringing us through all of it. Yes. Trials, the tribulations, the joy, and the pain. Yes. Lord, you've been so good.
Yes.
Lord, I just would like to thank you for Pastor and Pastor Billy, Pastor Lawson, and their families, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you for Beracah Baptist Church.
Yes.
Thank you for every member that's here, Lord. Thank you for all the faces.
Yes.
Lord, may each of us receive a special blessing.
Yes, Lord.
May our hearts be touched by the word. May we be fed abundantly, Lord, with your word, Lord.
Yes.
May we receive it in our hearts and may we repeat it, Lord. All we need to do is say what you say.
Yes.
Take nothing away, Lord.
Yes.
Just repeat your word.
Yes.
Thank you for the privilege of witnessing to others, Lord, about the goodness, the richness, the fullness that you bring us, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you for the Sunday school lesson,
Thank
Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you so much that we are justified through Jesus Christ.
Yes,
Lord.
Thank you.
The perfect propitiation for our sins, Lord.
Yes, thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Heard a song, Lord, how can a brown cow eat green grass and produce white milk? But Lord, here I am a sinner, Lord, and I get washed in your blood while you're sinning. Thank you for that, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
That you,
thank you.
You forgive all my sins, Lord.
Yes. Thank you.
I have you to depend on, Lord.
Yes.
Just thank you for Jesus Christ, Lord.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
May hearts be blessed in the name of Jesus. Yes. Amen.
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 Minister at another church and at a conference, but there's no place like home.
Amen.
So it's good to see each of you. Been praying for you and thank the Lord for this opportunity to worship again with you here at Beracah. And so our scripture for the day comes from Matthew 5. And by the way, just to give you a quick update, as far as I know, my mother-in-law is doing better. That's indicated by the fact that she's back in her own place and managing. So thank you for your prayers and continue praying for her and for my wife. Pray for her as well. She's having a flare-up right now, so that's why she's not here with us today. Pray that she'll recuperate and recover. But we thank God. I wanted to say publicly, not to embarrass her, but congratulations to Simone on graduating from high school. That's a tremendous accomplishment. We're pretty excited about that. I told her this morning we're proud of her, and we're looking forward to losing both her and Monet sometime in August as they go off to college. So keep them in prayer, and pray for Monet's mother and related members, and pray for especially pray for Pastor Bailey and Sister Bailey, because then they got to shell out some big bucks. They thought they paid some money before for her going to that private school, but it's big college bucks, and some of us remember that. So pray for the brother that they'll be able to support her as she goes off to school. That's a big transition, but we're rejoicing in the Lord for his goodness. Amen. So I just wanted to say that publicly about her, and we're just so proud of that accomplishment in her life and her going forward. Well, I'm reading Matthew 5. Pastor Bailey's been preaching out of the Beatitudes. And of course, this is the first major sermon of Jesus in the book of Matthew. And it's Matthew, rather, formulates his gospel based on the five speeches of Jesus, this being the first one. So, Matthew 5, 1 to 12. And seeing the multitude, he went up on a mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before them." May God bless the reading of his holy word.
Amen. Amen. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It's good to see you in the house of God this morning for this final Sunday in the month of May. We're fastly moving to the middle part of this year, and what a time we are having. I do want to acknowledge any visitors or guests that we have with us today. Would you be so kind as to stand if you're a first time, second time, or third time? Doesn't matter. We want to acknowledge you properly and treat you well here at Beracah. All visitors and guests, would you please stand at this time? Amen, amen. Let's give our guest a hand this morning. Just kind of tell us who you are and how you came to be a part of our fellowship today.
Well, my name is Christine Gatt, and this is my great-granddaughter, Kennedy Taylor. First, give an honor to my Lord and Savior and to you, Reverend Bell, and to the other members. I don't feel like I'm a visitor. I'm a former member here. I was for many years. And as I came in, I saw your theme, a new season of ministry.
Amen.
God has used you to take this place to another level, another height. It is truly all blessing.
Oh, praise God.
I see the tremendous change as to when I was a member here. Mm-hmm. I see a lot of my old friends are still here. And of course, Mrs. Cockdale, Cynthia, Randy, she said, "You got to come back."
Amen. God bless you. Well, thank you. Thank you for fellowshipping with us today. God bless you. We trust that God will speak to your heart and bless you real good for being with us today. Well, Beracah, let's spend a few moments and fellowship with one another. Greet one another in the love of Jesus Christ. And let's welcome even those that we haven't spoke to yet. Let's take the time now to walk around the room, to hug their neck, shake their hand. Welcome them.
Hallelujah.
Nehemiah 8:6, and Ezra blessed the Lord.
the great God, and all the people answered, amen. Amen. Lifting up their hands, they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. When we receive a word from the Lord, our answer should be, amen. Let the church say,
amen. Grab that last handshake, that last hug, if you will. Make your way back to your seat as we continue in worship. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, choir, for serving this morning in praise and worship, and for all of us being in the house of God to give God praise and to give God worship. What an awesome privilege and opportunity we have. To all of our guests and visitors, thank you so much for being with us today. If you'd be so kind as to fill out this visitor's card, if you have not done so already, fill that out in its entirety and place it in the offering plate along with your offering this morning. We want to keep a record of your attendance with us today. Also, you're going to receive a complimentary CD, which is our gift to you for being our special guest with us today. And to all of our members and friends, if you need a giving envelope this morning, please ask one of the ushers. They'll be so happy to give you one as we prepare to worship God through giving in just a moment. We've been blessed here at this great church. And I got to stop saying a little church because we're, you know, size, that's not really the main focus. But we've been blessed at this congregation over the last several years to have special guests to come through, whether it be by way of preaching or whether it be by way of music. And we are so excited to have with us again Sister Dominique Horton. She's from What church? What church is that again? St. Matthew's Baptist Church. And had the opportunity to meet her pastor last year. I think it was a function we had at Woodstream Christian Academy where some of the clergy from the community came together. And her pastor was one of those pastors that got a chance to meet. And she's been here before, no stranger to Beracah. But we're excited about the opportunity now to have her back here in 2015. So would you put your hands together, give a warm, warm welcome to Sister Dominique as she comes to minister in song.
Amen. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
First, give an honor to God, who is the head of my life, to your amazing pastor, Pastor Bailey, members and friends, thank you all so much. I feel like I just came home today. You guys welcomed me. And it is really so amazing because you go places and people are, you know, they're not really nice, you know, and they don't always welcome you. But not really, the love and the spirit of this church has truly blessed me. So I thank you all for inviting me back. And I hope that you all are blessed. Okay. Lord, if I find favor in your sight, Lord, please hear my heart's cry. I'm desperately waiting to be where you are. I'll cross the hottest desert, I travel near or far for your glory. I will do anything just to see you, to behold you as my King. Lord, if I find favor in your sight, Lord, please hear my heart's cry. I'm desperately waiting to be where you are. I'll cross the hottest desert, I travel near or far for your glory. I will do anything just to see you, to behold you as my King. For your glory, see you, to behold you as my King, cause I wanna be where you are, cause peace is where you are, joy is where you are. I wanna be where you are, Jesus, I wanna be where you are. I've gotta be where you are. I wanna be where you are. I gotta be where you are. For your glory, I will do anything just to see you, to behold you as my King. I wanna be where you are. Lord, I gotta be where you are. I wanna be where you are. I gotta be where you are.
Amen. Let the church say amen. Amen. How many of you want to be where the Lord is? Close to Him. Wow. Isn't that a voice? Lord, have mercy. Flowing like water. A cappella. When folk can sing Acapulco, I was tempted to run over to the piano, but I said, no. That was a blessing. That was an acapella blessing. God bless you. Amen. She's going to come right before the message this morning with another selection. We're excited about what God is doing in the life of our church. There is a VBS slide. If we can go there for the announcement scroll, there's a VBS slide I want to put up on the screen for you. We do have a VBS theme for this year, for July 13th through 18th. And, of course, the 18th is our community fun day. But the 13th through the 17th, that week, we are going to the edge. Going to the edge with our VBS community fun day. We're going to have a brief meeting following our service for all those that signed up for VBS. Please plan to attend a brief meeting to give you more information and to get some of these slots filled as to the different tasks and roles that need to be filled for that week of Vacation Bible School. So as they're listed in your bulletin, some of those are some that are not listed in your bulletin. But at any rate, be praying and thinking of how you can serve. Amen. And we need everyone to serve. Amen. Everyone to serve in some capacity as we reach our community. This is our largest effort outreach to our community. And we want everybody to be involved in reaching this Oxon Hill area for the glory of God. All right. I want to give special thanks to those that attended yesterday for our Child Evangelism Fellowship prayer brunch. We are so grateful to open our doors to the ministry of CEF, Beverly Carroll, along with Director Michael Thompson and Renee Walker, as they came in, and many of you were a part of that congregation that assembled on yesterday. And what a time, what a time, what a time. All those that attended the prayer brunch yesterday, just raise your hand. Amen. We had a good showing from Beracah Baptist Church. Amen. And we're so grateful for that. It was a blessing to them to see how many are interested and involved and getting involved in the ministry and life of CEF. We support them as missionaries here locally, as they evangelize children in five-day clubs, in the school system, during the summer months. That's what they're gearing up for now. Outreach in the community areas here in D.C., and surrounding areas, and we're excited. They also help us with our ministry outreach here in this Oxon Hill area, so we're grateful for the partnership and for those that have come alongside to work and to serve with CEF. So continue to pray for their ministry as they do the work of the ministry here in this D.C. area. We're excited about our new members class. So next Sunday, we're going to conclude this next batch that is going, not batch, this that is so impersonal. It's not a warehouse. We're so excited about this group that is coming through, a group of two. Amen. Two sisters. Sister Mary, Sister Shirley, just raise your hand. Amen. Amen. We're excited about them, and they're excited about us, and we're excited about this opportunity. They can become a part of our church. And, I as a pastor, I just love exciting people. I love exciting members, and nothing thrills my heart more than to see people walk through the doors and follow Christ, as whether it be salvation or church membership, and they come and they're so excited about what God is doing in their lives, and then how they can get involved within the life of the church, and there's no different now. So we thank God for our new members that are coming along. Let's encourage them and pray for them as they become a part of our church. All right. Everything else listed in your bulletin is as is. We're so grateful again for your. We have the new daily breads are out on the table. Please feel free to pick those up as well. We do those every quarter, so feel free to pick those up as well. We are so excited about the opportunity to share with Simone on last week and the love
and just the way that you guys outpoured on her on last Sunday was tremendous. And on behalf of Simone, as her parents, Shanita and I, we thank you for blessing her in such a great and awesome way as we celebrate her graduation. As it was stated earlier, keep her in prayer. She continues to work towards college. That's a big step. It's a step of independence. It's a step of that costs some money. And amen. But we know God's going to provide the need. Because what the text was on last Sunday, acknowledge him in all of your ways and he will direct your path. God will provide at every level of life, no matter what it costs, no matter what it is. If it's his will, he will provide the means. So we thank God for his promises, and we thank God for what he's going to do in the life of Simone. So I know her heart was encouraged and still is as she goes through this time of celebration. All right. We want to prepare ourselves now for the offering. So ushers, would you make your way to the front this time as we prepare to give in the morning tithes and offerings? The Bible says he loves a cheerful giver. Let's give to the Lord with that type of attitude, that type of spirit. And this is an act of worship, just like singing, worship, songs, and all that we've done thus far. Let's worship through giving, realizing that God is worthy of all that we have. Let's bow in a word of prayer as we prepare for the morning offering. Father, thank you for the opportunity we have to give. Bless the giver and the gift. Take it, multiply, and use it for your glory and for your honor, that your kingdom agenda might be accomplished, and that, Father, your people might be blessed as we serve you. So take this now, I pray. Be pleased with our giving in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give to the Lord this morning.
Just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done.
Come on, blessing.
Blessing and
glory. They all belong. Thank you, Jesus.
For blessing me.
Come on, let's go higher.
I just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me.
Blessing. One more time, blessing.
you. Thank you, Jesus. Stay right there. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, somebody ought to thank him this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Put those hands together and give God some thanks up in here. Yeah!
Hallelujah. We come to thank him this morning. For he's worthy. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Sister Dominique, come back and bless us one more time before the message this morning. Come on, give her good God bless you.
Thank you. make it through this week. My car broke down. My clothes ripped on the way to church. Y'all, I got scars all over my legs. I got wet pantyhose and be hot. I have been through it all this week. I've almost lost my mind. But thanks be to God, if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, you don't look like what you've been through. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Well, go on and give God praise. Come on, come on, come on. Somebody help her praise the Lord. Somebody help her magnify the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Gonna hasten to his throne. His throne is where we find help in the time of need. Dominic, you're right in the will of God through whatever God is allowing you to go through. He's perfecting you. He's maturing you. He's positioning you so his purpose can be accomplished in your life. God bless you for your faithfulness to him. And Father, we come before you humbled this morning because we need a word from you right now. Would you pour into us those character qualities, those attributes that are like Jesus? Would you empty us of everything that is not like Jesus? Would you continue to sanctify us? Make us so that we're usable. Set us apart continually for your work and for your glory. The reason why we open up your word this morning is so that we can be changed. If there's anyone amongst us that has a religious mentality, God, I pray that you would change it right now by the influence of your Holy Spirit. That each of us would sit with eagerness, with a ready and receptive heart to receive the truth of God's word. Not just as a church, but as individuals, because that's where you want us to start. Help us right now to receive. Would you speak by your power? Speak by your word. I pray that if there's one among us that does not know Jesus in the part of their sin, that today would be the day of salvation for them. Whatever it is, supply the need. Encouragement, correction, maybe even discipline, whatever it is, you be Lord in this house. And we're so glad that we're here. Speak now, Holy Spirit, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We've been going through the Beatitudes. If you have your Bible open to Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 5, as we continue in our series, Discipleship 101. And as we continue in this great text, It is a great text. It is a great sermon discourse that Jesus is giving here in Matthew 5. And it speaks in so many different ways, bit by bit and level by level. The first thing we discovered is that verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And we learn what that means as far as being bankrupt before God and needing him for everything, life, in this life and life eternally, knowing that we have nothing to offer God, but God is the one ultimately that does the salvation, the saving. Verse 4, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And as we position ourselves to reflect on ourselves as Christ sees ourselves, it ought to induce a mourning, a crying, a lamenting,
Because without God, we are absolutely, finish the phrase for me, we're absolutely nothing. Verse 5, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. We learn what that means as far as being saddled under the hand of God, under the rule, under the authority of Jesus Christ. And no matter what this life brings our way, and no matter what the issues are that are tossed at us, we can respond with a certainty, and we can respond and interact not out of control, but rather under control. Being meek is simply being under the power and the control of the Spirit. In verse 6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. And we learn that this is an inward appetite that we ought to have for the things of God. And he says, blessed are those that have this appetite and who have this internal desire. Everybody doesn't have a desire for God, but we ought to become God chasers. We ought to be God pursuers. We ought to be pursuing God's word. We ought to have an inward drive, not for things outside of the things of God or outside of the will of God, but as children of God, we ought to have a desire for the things of God. That is one of the signs that we belong to God, because our heart is bent towards the things of God. Our mind has been renewed because of God. And our spirit, now we're drawn towards the things of God. If you never had a desire for righteousness, you and I ought to have a desire and a hunger and a thirst for those things that are right. That only comes from pursuing the righteous one, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now, verse 7. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the merciful. I want to entitle this text this morning, as we have it, this seventh installment here. Fifth installment. Receiving and extending. Receiving and extending. Receiving and extending. And several things I want to walk through this morning as we unpack this text in verse 7. Blessed are the merciful. We're going to talk about what being merciful is, but first we're going to talk about what mercy is. What is mercy? What does the Bible say about mercy? Point number one, what is mercy? It's compassion. Here's one definition I found. Compassion or forgiveness shown towards someone whom it is within one's power to punish or harm. Listen to that definition again. Compassion or forgiveness shown towards someone whom it is within one's power to punish or to harm. In other words, we have the capacity to make a decision. We can administer justice or mercy. And the punishment and the harshness and the harm that is probably rightfully deserving is there to be decided upon, but we have a decision to make to be merciful or to show mercy in that situation or towards that person. Each of us have a decision and a choice to make when we talk about mercy. The first thing I want you to understand as we unpack this idea and definition of mercy is that mercy is made for challenging relationships. Mercy is made for challenging relationships. It's designed for conflict. The whole idea of mercy, listen, if we didn't have any issues, if we didn't have people issues, if we didn't have relationship issues, if we didn't have any conflict personally in nature, we would not have a need for mercy. Mercy is not needed where there is perfection. Mercy is needed where there is imperfection. Mercy is to be applied where there are challenging relationships. And each of us, you don't have to be saved to understand what mercy is. But when we grow in our understanding of Christ, we come to an understanding and a further knowledge of what mercy really is, biblical in nature. And we need to open our eyes and understanding to understanding what Jesus says this thing is and how we ought to respond to it, because we have a two-way road. As we're going to discover today, we are all recipients of God's mercy. We are all recipients of God's mercy, and we are equally all responsible to be extenders of that same mercy. In other words, we receive, but we are to give. Each and every one of us have that responsibility. The challenge is, are we taking that responsibility seriously? Are we understanding what has been given to us
And are we understanding what we are to give? Because it's a two-way street. So keep that in mind as we walk through the text this morning. It's a two-way street. Mercy is made for challenging relationships. By show of hands, how many of you have ever experienced a challenging relationship? It might be with a child, it might be with a spouse, it might be with co-workers. I don't care what the relationship is in nature. All of us have experienced challenging relationships. People that we don't get along with, people that we don't necessarily like, people that don't necessarily like us, people that don't understand us, or we don't have a proper understanding of them. And it presents challenges within earthly relationships. You know you've had a challenging relationship when you've been hurt. You all of us can understand pain and hurt when we thought one thing, but it turned out to be another. When we planned for one thing, but reality was totally different. And the result is that we've been hurt. Many of us have pulled back from relationships because of challenges and that hurt that still remains. The person can be long gone. The scenario has been almost forgotten, but the hurt is still alive. The hurt is still prevalent. The hurt is still present day because, listen, it is reality. We get hurt in relationships. We get hurt because of missed and unaccounted for expectations, and that hurt is real. Mercy is needed for challenging relationships. There is no relationship that is rebuilt without mercy. There is no broken home that is mended and put back together without mercy. There is no marriage that is put back together without mercy. You can't even forgive somebody who's wronged you without mercy. You can't even receive, listen, the things that God has for us unless we realize that mercy is the glue intermingled between all these things that we want in our lives to take the place of that pain and that hurt. But God says you and I need to have a healthy understanding of what mercy is and how it operates in the midst of real life scenarios. Because many of us disassociate this biblical concept from the real hurt that we feel. And what we do when we hurt, guess what? We go back to the old way of dealing with that hurt. Some of us get angry and we're outward with it. We're vocal with it. We're headstrong. We're determined that hurt people. Listen, hurt people hurt people. You do realize that. Hurt people hurt people. It's the way things happen. If it's not dealt with properly, if mercy has not been understood, then hurt people will eventually hurt other people. And the church is no different. Let's not fool ourselves this morning. The church house is no different. We get hurt just like the world gets hurt. We go through difficulty just like the world, just like unsaved folk who don't even name the name of Jesus Christ. It's not a unique thing to the body of Christ, but what ought to be unique to the body is that we have a biblical foundation and a biblical perspective on how to deal with this same hurt. It's called mercy. It's called mercy. Let's unspiritualize this word for just a moment. We're going to get to the cross. We're going to get to Jesus. We're going to get to his goodness towards us. But let's talk about it on an earthly level for a moment. Because mercy is needed. Mercy is that ointment. Mercy is that band-aid. Mercy is that surgery that heals the hurt. It takes the pain and deals with the issue and provides healing. But there can be no healing if there is no mercy. And if we are merciless people, if we lack the very quality of Jesus himself, you do realize the reason why he came and died on the cross was because he was merciful in nature. We didn't sign petitions and send it up to heaven and say, would you please provide salvation? No, he did it because he loved us and he's merciful towards sinners. We're crying about our hurt. We hurt him. We wronged him. We blasphemed his name. We took his name in vain. We squandered the very things that God calls precious, and yet he still was merciful towards us. Think about what we still do as believers. Think about how we still act as believers. Think about how our attitude still needs to be adjusted as believers. How our words still need to be seasoned with salt as believers. And he's still merciful. Still good like that. Oh, you ought to give him praise for his mercy in here. All of us have been in challenging relationships. And if our relationship with God is not a challenging relationship, I don't know what it is. People that just won't do right even when you love them. People that won't turn around and say thank you even when you bless them. People that won't even acknowledge your presence and your activity in their lives even when you open doors for them. That's how we do God. But God is a merciful God. Mercy is made for challenging relationships. When you've been hurt, when trust has been broken. You know, when trust has been broken, it's not easy to rebuild. Sometimes many people never rebuild because of trust being broken. And we take that hurt, that brokenness, that broken spot in our lives into the next relationship, into the next level. And we're faking it until we make it, but we never make it because it's got to be healed. And God says mercy is that healing ointment, is that character quality. If you let me have your hurt, let me have your pain, let me have your brokenness, I'll put it back together again. I'm not asking you to rebuild your life. I'm asking you to let me rebuild your life. Because he's a merciful God. Mercy that can handle hurt and brokenness, but also mercy that can handle pain that has been inflicted. Sometimes it's from without. Sometimes it's from within. You do realize that pain doesn't always come from someone doing something to you. Many times we can be in a room all by ourselves and go through the same anguish as if we're in a fist fight with someone externally. But we're beating up ourselves. We're fighting with me. Many times that is a never-ending battle. You can whip somebody else, but you struggle to whip yourself. How do you win when you can't even handle yourself? How do you come to a conclusion and get over something when you can't even help yourself with yourself? And many of us, we deal with self issues and internal issues, and we need the mercy of someone greater than us. Because we'll be like a dog that keeps on chasing his tail and keeps on chasing his tail. And when do you end? When do you stop? When do you catch your tail? When do you actually come to a conclusion? When does it get better? No, you just keep going around and around. And I know I look foolish right now, but that's what we look like. This is exactly what we look like. Now I'm dizzy. Self-inflicted. Mercy can help us. It's made for challenging relationships. Secondly, mercy is made for changing times. Changing times. Mercy is a timeless character quality. It's timeless. In other words, it was good 2,000 years ago. It was good back in the Old Testament. It was good yesterday. It'll be good tomorrow. It's a timeless. It has no time attached to it. The Bible says his mercy endures forever. It's a timeless quality that is needed at all times. Under any circumstances, it's not unique to a person. It's not unique to a time frame or what's going on in this day and age versus back in the 50s and 60s or back in the 1800s or back in medieval times. And times come and go. That's our way of measuring events. But this is a timeless truth and quality that God gives to the body of Christ to understand and to receive and to give. It's a timeless character quality. Mercy is needed at every area of life. Think about this. Little baby resting. Mercy is needed at that level because that baby can't fend for himself. That child needs a parent. That child needs, listen, youth, toddlers, mercy is needed because they're danger, and guess what? They don't even know danger's around. go to the edge of a step, and they don't think that way. Mercy is needed even at the areas of stages of living and growth, babies, youth, adults, and seniors, and on and on and on. Guess what? Mercy is needed at every level of our lives. And may we never get to a point where we think we don't need the mercy of God. May we never get to a point in our lives where we feel like we've arrived. Because that's the point in which we fall. When the Bible says pride goes before a fall, what it's really saying is this. Here are the people that think they don't need to operate under the mercy of God. Pride and a proud and an arrogant spirit is someone who thinks they don't need the provision of God himself and what he has done to give us what we need so we can move in a direction that will bring glory to him. Pride says, I'm going to do it myself. What's that song? I did it my way. We sing that song for how we live our lives. And God says, no, you didn't do it your way. If you do it your way, you're going to ruin your life. But I'm going to give you something that's going to help you when you get cut and beat up and bruised so you can bounce back. So you don't have to overdose on drugs. So you don't have to binge drink and do things that take matters into your own. So you don't have to go around killing folk just to get back because you are hurt and pain. So you don't have to commit suicide or attempted suicide. Why? Because I'm going to give you something that's going to help you with your struggle, with yourself, with your pain. See, in order to understand mercy, we got to understand why we need it. We got to understand just what we are in need of. Physically and spiritually. Made for changing times and challenging relationships. But thirdly, mercy is made for Christ-like people. Mercy is made for Christ-like people. Now here's where it gets personal. Because we need to understand as Christians what mercy is. First of all, it's who God is. Psalm 103 and verse 8 says this, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and plenteous in mercy. That's what the Bible says as it describes the very character of God. There are one, we clap our hands and worship and we sing songs of praise and we bow down before him in worship and we come and study his holy word and we fellowship and we serve the Lord with gladness. This is the God that we are acknowledging. He is plenteous. He is abundant. He is overflowing in mercy. Look at the text for yourself. It says he's slow to anger. As much as we want to put God in a negative light and make him seem like some intolerant tyrant who's after us to get us, God says about himself, I am slow to anger. That's not my first option. Yes, I'm a God of judgment, but that's not my first option. Yeah, I know you sin and transgress my law, but I'm giving you time to turn around. I'm giving you an opportunity to change. I'm giving you space and time to get right with me. Why? Because I'm a merciful God. If you've been in Bible study, as we discovered and went through the Genesis, as we talked about the Noah and the flood, we discovered as they were leading up to the flood that God gave them an opportunity, even though their hearts were wicked and they would not turn. He knew that. But just because he is who he is, gracious and merciful, he gave them an opportunity. He gave them space and time to get right with him. Noah preached for about 100 years. It's going to rain as he built the ark. It's going to rain as he brought the wood. It's going to rain. And he preached and he preached and he preached. And those that heard him had an opportunity to respond to what he preached. God is a merciful God. He didn't have to give them time. He could have brought the flood on it immediately. He could have brought it swiftly. He could have brought judgment imminently. Listen, it was his mercy that withheld the flood waters. While there was a preacher on the scene that was holding a revival that no one attended. The mercy of God that held back what they were deserving of just so they could hear a message. What is God doing today? He's withholding back judgment so that those that are lost without God can hear the message of the gospel and respond. That's why we are here today. That's why we're saved today. That's why we're in the ministry today. Because God is using us to send forth a message. The message is a saying. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent. Turn to God. It's for Christ-like people. Because we need to understand, as Christ-like people, this is who Christ is. He's merciful. Slow to anger. Secondly, it's how he deals with us. It's how he deals with us. We'll get a little closer. Psalm 136. Turn there with me. Psalm 136. I love this. Psalm 136 is a redundant reminder of the mercy of God. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but as it begins, it says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good." What does it say? For his. Say that loud. What does it say? For his. Oh, give thanks to the God of gods. Oh, give thanks to the Lord of lords. To him who alone does great wonders. To him who by wisdom made the heavens. To him who laid out the earth above the waters. To him who made great lights. The sun to rule by day. The moon and stars to rule by night. And on and on and on the chapter goes to remind us in a repetitious way, because we tend to forget some things. So he reminds us in a repetitious way that God is a merciful God. And there is no issue, whether it be creation or recreation, if it has to be forgiveness or deliverance, whatever it is, God's mercy is greater. And that's what you and I need to understand today. God is a merciful God. That's who Christ is. He's a merciful Savior. He's a merciful Lord. He's not like those in antiquity and those in Greek mythology that would paint these deities to be intolerant, mean, angry. Always, if it's thunder and lightning, the gods are not happy. If some tornado takes place, the gods are not pleased. And we were paranoid. That leads to a paranoia. And God sets himself apart from those false gods and those false ideas of deity. And he says, listen, I'm not what you suppose I am. I am a merciful God who is extending mercy to you and to those that will follow me. What I want you to do is extend that same mercy to others. Help me spread it around. Because if we receive, we are to extend. This is who he is. But not only should we understand God's mercy, but in this section, we all should understand that we need God's mercy. We need God's mercy. Would you say that with me? I need God's mercy. Say it one more time. I need God's mercy. Lamentations chapter 3 and verse 22 and 23 says this: it is of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed. Amen. Somebody ought to say amen right there. Because his compassions, here's the reason why. It's not because you do everything right. It's not because you jot every, cross every T and dot every I. No, no, no. It is because of his compassions that we fail not. It's because his compassions fail not. That's the reason why we're not consumed. Because they're new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. You understand the reason why you and I are not consumed or punished or utterly destroyed? Because of our pain, because of our issues, because of our failures in our lives. It's because God is a merciful God. The only reason you and I made it in 2015 because of God's mercy. I don't care what kind of car you drove up in here on today. You are riding on God's mercy. I don't care what kind of house you live in. You're living in God's mercy. I don't care what kind of clothes you got on your back. You are suited in the mercy, wrapped up, tied up, tangled up in the mercy of God. To think any other way is to miss the truth of what God is saying. To walk out cocky thinking you make your world go around. To walk out understanding with a thwarted understanding of what really matters in life is to miss the whole point. It's because of the Lord's mercies that you and I are alive today. It's because of God's mercy. I want to drive this home. I'm going to move on a minute, and I might just be done early. But I'm going to drive this nail in the stake right now. It's because of God's mercy that you didn't die when you should have died. It's because of God's mercy that you didn't die in that car wreck, in that car crash. It's because of God's mercy you still got two limbs and two legs. It's because of God's mercy you're not on that medication today. It's because of God's mercy. It's not because of how much money you make. It's not because of the resources that you have or the influence that you have or who's who and who's in your cell phone. No, it's because God has been gracious and God has been merciful. Think about how things could have been and probably because of our activity should have been. But God. Some of y'all sleeping on me today, but that's all right. I'll get happy all by myself. The only reason I'm pastoring this church is because of God's mercy and God's grace. I feel like the songwriter. I never would have made it without you. I'm better. I'm wiser. I'm stronger. All because of Jesus. Somebody give God praise for his mercy. Hallelujah. 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 Thank God for mercy. Thank God it didn't run out on me when I didn't deserve it. Mercy is not earned. Mercy is not deserved. Listen, we don't get it because we're good. That defeats the purpose of even having it. We get it because God is gracious, and God is loving, and God is compassionate, and God is moved with compassion on undeserving subjects like you and me that could never earn it on our own. We could never do enough good to get it. Thank God. Thank God. Thank God for the mercy of God. Thank God that he loves you anyhow. Thank God that he's there and he promised never to leave you. Woo, Jesus. Hey, glory. I understand that I need his mercy for myself. It changes my perspective. If I got an attitude problem, there is my attitude adjustment right there. Because when I look at my need, I got to admit, because we're going to be honest with ourselves. We might underestimate somebody else and distort their need, but when it comes to ourselves, we're going to be true and honest. I need God's mercy. I need it on Tuesday. I need it on a Wednesday. I need it on a Monday or Sunday. I need it every day of my life. Because I know what I'm struggling with. I know what I'm dealing with. And I know my own personal failures. You might not know mine, and I might not know yours. But one thing, God knows all of us inside out, and he still loves us. Understand the mercy of God and understand that we need God's mercy. The third thing in this section, understand that we must extend mercy to others. Let's move on a little closer. We talked about understanding who God is in this context. And we talked about our need for what God has provided for us. But now let's see what we do with it. Because here's where a lot of us just unplug and we become parasites. We get, we take, and we go on about our business. And God says, you missed the point. I've gifted you with this mercy. I've gifted you with mercy. Not so you can just be a hoarder of it, but so you can receive it and extend it. Understand, thirdly, that we must extend his mercy to others. Luke chapter 10 and verse 30 through 37. I'm not going to turn there, but this is the text of the Good Samaritan. And there were many that walked past this person that was by the wayside and by the roadside in need of attention, in need of help, and no one would help them. And then the text tells us that this Samaritan came and took care of the needs of this one in need. Let me tell you something. That's mercy. That is a direct picture of what God has done for us. The world is walking by. The world, those that don't love our God, are walking by. But yet, there's one that saw fit to stop, to help you and me, to provide salvation, whatever we stood in need of. He put it on his account. That's what Jesus did. He paid it all, as the song says. All to him I owe. You know, it's such a profound understanding, because we were helpless and totally helpless and still are totally helpless without the activity and the mercy of God. So to withhold extending this grace and mercy to someone else in need is to have a brain freeze, if you will. A disconnect somewhere where we forget what we just experienced. It blows my mind how God can bless us in our lives. Let me just be practical for a minute. How God can provide our needs in our lives and answer our prayer and provide for our needs. And then we turn around and act like we don't know what God just did. Somebody else comes up to us in need and we act like we didn't just see God in our lives. Like it's a foreign language now. It's a foreign concept now. And we don't know how to be the hands and the feet of Jesus practically in someone else's life. And let me tell you something. The Bible says perfect love casts out all fear. So when we talk about the character and the qualities of Jesus that he's trying to implement in our lives, let me tell you what's happening. We don't have reason to fear helping someone else. And you know, we say, preacher, what if they don't respond the right way? No, that's not in our jurisdiction. They got to answer to God for that. You just be like Jesus. Jesus, he healed the lepers, but only one came back to say thank you. So everybody's not going to get the point. Don't expect everybody to get the point. There's some folk that just want to get what they're going to get, and they're going to go on their way. Well, they're going to have to deal with it on their own. But listen, you and I need to be faithful in giving and extending mercy, expecting nothing in return. If we limit it to what we think is fair, first of all, we jacked up on what's fair. How are we gonna really lay this thing out and be fair with it? No, we're biased. We are naturally biased because it's gonna be bent always in our favor. We are not fair. We think we are. We don't operate in fairness. So get that off the table and put mercy on the table. And let God deal with what is just, because we don't understand justice in its totality. God says, be merciful. Let me close this thing. The second half of the message is how do we become this? How do we become merciful? Let's make it practical. How do we become merciful? Number one, I want you to get this. These are three easy to remember things. Renew. Everybody say renew.
Renew your focus on Christ and the cross. Here's where the spiritual comes in. Renew your focus on Christ and the cross. I want you to hear this today. Let's look at Jesus and Peter. Peter did what? He denied Jesus. He messed up. Had an opportunity to own his faith. Had an opportunity to own his relationship with Jesus. But he denied it. He denied him in John 18:15. He denied Jesus. But over in John 21:15, Jesus forgave Peter. He went back to Peter and Peter got that thing right. And Jesus received him back and used him in a great and awesome way. But we got to renew our focus on how Jesus handles this. Renew our focus on him and his activity. Because all of us blow it. See, the focus is not on people. Your focus ought to be on Christ. Don't be overconsumed with relationships that are broken and people that just won't do right. No, put your focus on God, because he'll teach you. He'll train you. And many of us, we have to relearn this thing in a brand new way. It has nothing to do with age, because remember, mercy is timeless. So in whatever level you are, mercy is there. And it can be understood. It can be had. It can be a part of your life. It can be a part of how you interact with people. And listen, remember, mercy is needed for hard times and challenging relationships. And if this wasn't a challenging time in Peter's life, I don't know what is. Here he is, the one that has been gracious and good and loving towards him, and he blows it. Wow. If that's not depressing, when you know you had an opportunity to stand up for Jesus and you didn't, how many of us have done that? We had an opportunity to stand for what is right and we didn't. We had an opportunity to say what God says and we didn't. We had an opportunity to share our faith and witness for God and we didn't. How many times maybe somebody questioned us and we felt like we were being cornered and we resisted. We tried to slip out and maneuver around the issue and not own our relationship with God. God knew it. Some of us right now, we're living through that where we're negating the very thing that God has called us to. We need to renew our focus on Christ. We need to renew our focus on Christ. In other words, we need to remember and refocus rather on what is most important. Jesus and his ministry. Jesus and his cross. What about Jesus in the world? Luke 23:34, Jesus on the cross cried out. And this is a global prayer. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. If that ain't mercy. Even while they're crucifying me, forgive them. Even when they spat on me, forgive them. They placed a crown of thorns on my head, forgive them. There's a spear hole in my side, forgive them. I've been beat until I am unrecognizable. But God, forgive them. Father, forgive them. Because they're acting in ignorance. They don't know what they're doing. They don't realize the severity of what they're doing. They don't realize what they're saying. They're ignorant sheep. They're ignorant people. Don't hold this to their account. I'm dying yet for them. I'm sacrificing my life even now for their redemption. So God, would you forgive them? God, would you be merciful to them? The reason why I stand and preach the gospel in this day and age is because God is full of mercy, full of compassion. Doesn't matter who's in the audience. God's mercy can wash your sins, can hold you from destruction so you can be saved. There's some tools here that can handle the hardest criminal. There's some mercy here that can pardon even those who are guilty as charged. There's some grace here that can provide even in the most obscure circumstances. God can save anybody, change anybody, transform anybody. I don't care what it is. Come into the contact of a God who's full of grace and mercy. And I'm just convinced that if any of us have ever been a recipient of God's mercy, we don't have a problem extending it.
I am convinced, to a person who does not extend mercy to others, who has a problem with relationships with others, who cannot get along with others, who cannot forgive others, we don't have a proper focus on Christ. I don't care how much Bible you know. If you can't forgive your neighbor that you see every day, you're not as tight with God as you think you are. Y'all ain't got to say amen. It's time to renew your focus. Every so often, I got to go into the optometrist because this prescription is not necessarily what I need. 2 years from now, 5 years from now, it might change. I need to go in and renew my focus so I can see better, so I know where I'm stepping, so I can see what I'm reading. Because it's not that this changes, but my eyesight changes. And I'm here to tell you, you and I might need to go to Jesus this morning and say, Lord, renew my focus. Get my attention again. I started looking at you, but I've drifted. I need to have a renewed focus on you. Don't bank on your past experience to be the same today, because we're changing. Sometimes it's not for the better. Challenges and pain and brokenness and all these things have a way of pulling us away from the very thing that God is calling us to. And if we're not careful, we will drift with a Bible in hand. Drift. With a song on our lips. Drift. While we're yet serving God, still drifting. Drifting and don't even know it. Nearer my God to thee while we're walking away from him. And we don't even realize what's happening in our lives. Going down and think we're doing the will of God. But I want to tell you this morning, renew your focus on God. Understand where you are and get back where you need to be because of God's mercy. Let me move on. Renew your focus on Christ and his cross. Secondly, rewind your life. Somebody say rewind. Rewind your... I know we don't use that button anymore because we got electronics. We don't have to rewind anymore. That's for tape decks and all that stuff. But rewind your life and remember how good God has been to you. I'm here to tell you this morning, we need to remember. We need to go back in retrospect and remember and rewind that our lives unfolded so we can see it for what it is. The means of becoming full of mercy is someone who understands how much mercy you actually possess. How much mercy God has actually extended to you. Get a healthy dose of reality. Listen to yourself pray. Some of us don't do that. Listen how do you pray. Listen to how you pray. I'll guarantee you 95% of what we say. We might use different words. It might be a different sentence. It might be a different request. But really what we're asking for, God, I need your mercy. Keep me safe as I travel. I'm asking for mercy. God, I got financial difficulties. I'm asking for mercy. Oh, God, I need healing in my body. I'm asking for mercy. And so many times in so many different ways, we're asking God for mercy. And guess what God does each and every day? Simply because his stock supply is new every morning, like Lamentation tells us. We are asking God, supply my needs today, even though I don't deserve it. Even though I'm unworthy. Even though I blew it. Even though I blew it last night. Even though I blew it last Friday. Even though I said what was wrong. Even though I didn't measure up. I didn't keep my end of the bargain. But God, be merciful to me. And you know what? You know what? Somebody say what? Here's what. Sometimes we don't even ask God for it. Sometimes we don't even pray and ask God for it. But guess what a loving, compassionate God does? He gives it to us anyhow, anyway. Why? Because he's full of it. But you need to remind your mind, your life. We need to do this. Joshua 24, do like Joshua said. If it seemed, he went through a list, Joshua went through a list of all things that God had done for them. And he's, it ends it in verse 15. It says, if it seems evil to you, if it's wrong somehow for you, after God has done all this, delivered you from all kinds of enemies, preserved you from all kinds of destruction, brought you to where you are, and if it seems evil and wrong for you, it says, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Rewind your life. Come up with the right conclusion. After all God has done for me, after all the mercy of God I find around me, who wouldn't extend the same mercy to others? How dare we take any other position? Thirdly and finally, here's the last thing. Not only renew your focus and rewind your life, but remember your calling. Remember your calling. This is where Jesus gets up personal in your face. Matthew 5:39, in the same text we're in. He says, but I say to you that ye resist not evil, but whoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. One of those texts that we find hard to chew. We find hard to digest. But yet it's in our Bible. Extend mercy to others, even when they wrong you. Now here he's talking about personally. Now, certainly, corporately or with our culture, there are things, laws in place, and there are the things that people get in trouble, they go to jail. Yeah. But personally, one-on-one, what God is calling us to, hear this, is he's calling us to give up our personal rights. He's calling us, understand this, he's calling us to give up our personal rights. Because our natural inclination is to defend ourselves. Our natural inclination is to get upset and become defensive. But God says, stop doing the old way, because it ain't going to work if you're going to follow me. You're going to have to stop flying off the handle and kirking out and doing all this fleshly, carnal stuff. You got to stop it. I hear the Spirit just saying, stop it. Because what God is calling us to do is to start something new. Give up your personal rights. God will take care of you. Y'all didn't hear what I said? I said, God will take care of you. And if we can't take a little pressure here and there, if we can't take a little disappointment here and there, if we can't take somebody being upset with us here and there or being misunderstood, then we really don't understand what Jesus did in his ministry. Listen, Jesus was misunderstood. He was ridiculed. He was called a bastard. Why? Because you don't even know who your daddy is. You want to be the savior of the world. Get your own heritage correct. They didn't understand who he was. But yet he continued on to love them. God help us to swallow this today. Give up your personal rights. Stop defending your personal rights and let God be your defender. This is where it gets tough. You mean God? I gotta trust you. I'm leaning on you. I'm acknowledging you in all of my ways. This is a tough one, but I'm gonna lean back on you, and I know because you said, not because I'm looking, that you're gonna catch me. And what God is saying today, if you and I will give up our personal rights, our right to be right, our right to always have the upper hand, then we'll find out that God is gonna do some things in our lives that we never experienced before, because we wouldn't let him. We have not let him. There are some believers that just have not trusted God to that degree. We want to read the Bible on the surface. We want to be churchy and religious on the surface. But here is where it gets into our very core of our being and our heart. And this is the message today for the people of God in this sanctuary. Let God be your defender and extend the same thing you ask for every day. Give it away. Why? because somebody gave it to you. Stop defending yourself. Let God be your defense. Stop delivering justice without mercy. Many of us are concerned about our perspective, our version of justice. But I want you to understand right now, I'm just going to say it out plain. None of us understand what justice really is. Because if we did, we'd have to lock ourselves up. When we talk about justice, we talk about helping fix that person because they did that to me. We ain't talking about what we did to somebody else. Y'all ain't talking to me this morning. We don't understand what real justice is, but when God administers mercy, it's because he knows that if justice were on the table, all of us would be wiped out. None would be left standing. Room clear. No one here but the crickets. Why? Because all of us have broken God's law. All of us have wronged someone else. All of us have hurt somebody else. All of us are guilty as charged. Saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost is still guilty. Let God deliver justice in his way. But let's stop delivering justice without mercy. I'm convinced that churches would be healthier. Marriages would be stronger. Relationships, parent-child relationship, on your job, employee-employer, whatever it is, friendships, all these things would be more Christ-honoring if we would let God be the judge. If we would stop administering justice without mercy. Because we're applying it in the wrong areas. Thirdly and finally, start detecting God's mercy in your life and extending it to others. James chapter 2, and I'm in with this. James 2:13 says, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Let me read that again. Because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Notice what James says here. Those that walk around as if they're oblivious to the mercy of God in their lives, you're walking around like an unbeliever. You're walking around and you're carrying yourself as someone who does not know God, who knows nothing of the mercy of God, who doesn't understand the ways of God. And what he says here is, listen, if you handle yourself that way and carry yourself that way, you will not receive mercy. But he ends the verse with this: mercy triumphs over judgment. That'll preach all by itself. Mercy triumphs over judgment. That's a horse pill today that we got to swallow. Because there's some people in this room, even as I speak, you're struggling with administering mercy externally. Oh, you receive it internally, but you have a problem. And I'm going to put myself in that boat too. We have a problem extending mercy. But that's where God has us right now. Because what he wants to do in this moment, right now, right at 1 o'clock, he wants to help us with our struggle. Discipleship 101. You want to be like Jesus? Here he is meddling in your heart again. Blessed are the merciful. They shall obtain mercy. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray right now for the hearts and the minds of everybody in this room. There is a need right now for every heart to be open. There is a burning need because this is a door, God, that some of us have held locked, chained, and barred for so long. And we tried to manage relationships. We can't even get our relationship with you right because we won't even deal with our need. The issues, the merciless mentality that many of us carry around. But then we cry out in our pain and anguish for the mercy of God. but we won't extend it to others. God, help us in the point of our need. Open our heart right now and take that callus and that cancer out, because that's what it is to us. It is ruining us. It's stunting our growth. It's stagnating our progress. We're not moving forward. We're not developing. We're not becoming fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I just pray right now that you search us and know us. And if you see that wicked way in us, take it out right now. Take it out right now. Whether it be the past, maybe 20 years old, but take it out right now. 10 years old, 5 years old, yesterday, take it out right now. Whatever it is, God, take it out, remove it right now. Do divine surgery in our hearts right now. In the name of Jesus, take it out. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Give us a heart of flesh that can be molded. Look like Jesus. Forgive us of our sins. Forgive us of our iniquity. For many of us, this is a transgression right here. Because we know what your word says. We know what the scripture says. But we refuse to repent. We refuse to get it right. We refuse to let go. But right now, open our hearts so that we can let go. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. By the authority of your word, have your way right now in this atmosphere. I pray right now in the name of Jesus. Break chains. Break bondage. Set people free in the name of Jesus. Father, rebuke the enemy for our sakes right now, that we might have clarity of thought, that we might see ourselves as you see us, that we might review our lives and be honest in this moment of transparency before your hand, God, and before your presence. Have your way in this holy moment, I pray. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke every foul spirit that comes up against God's people. God, have your way. Have your way in this holy moment. Somebody's life weighs in the balance right now. Their dependency is in jeopardy right now. Their future is in jeopardy because they will not let go. But God, I pray that we'll let go right now. Let go right now. Open our hands and open our hearts to Jesus. Allow your mercy to flood our hearts. Flood everything carnal in nature out of it, that we might be like Jesus. Ain't nobody perfect in this room but Jesus. But God, help us to walk after your way. Nobody dots every I and crosses every T, but help us to follow Jesus and to learn of you. I pray this in Jesus' name. And every head bowed, every eye closed, I'm going to ask you this question. And they're going to sing this song. Have you given your heart to Jesus? If you were to die right now, would you wake up in heaven? Do you know without a shadow of a doubt that your name has been written in the Lamb's Book of Life? If you don't, today is the day of salvation for you. Right now, Jesus is calling you. And what he wants to do in your life is to change your life, save your life, and to give you everlasting life. Secondly, maybe there's somebody here saying, Pastor Bailey, I've given my heart to Jesus, but I need to rededicate my life to the Lord. Because as I understand what discipleship is and what it is not, I am so far from the plan of God, and I want to get there. I want to become what God wants me to be. I want to be like Jesus. And preacher, there's some areas in my life I struggle in. I'm just being honest in the presence of God. There's some things I struggle with, and I need deliverance. I need help. I need transformation. I need the mercy of God today on my life. Maybe that's you. Be honest. Let me tell you something. Don't walk out of this place cocky. Don't walk out of this place self-dependent. Walk out of this place leaning on Jesus. Because he will help you if you will cry out for that help. If you reach out for that help, he'll give it to you today. Thirdly and finally, maybe you want to join this church. Become a part of this fellowship where you can learn and grow in a deeper and better way. God wills that for your life. And we'd love to have you. As we all stand to our feet, I'm done. But the Spirit of God is still speaking. Everybody resting on your feet. You come, salvation, rededication, church membership. You come on, come on, come on, come on. I'm so serious this morning. Somebody needs to be down to this altar. Getting things right with God. I feel it in my spirit. You come to Jesus today. Man, woman, boy, or girl, you come. You come. You come. You come. Get it right. Get it right. In the name of Jesus, right now, in the house of God, you come. Don't put off for tomorrow what you can do today. Come on, come on, come on. Let him have his way in your life. Let him have his way in your life. Is there one today? Preacher, I need prayer. I need strength. I need direction. You meet me at this altar. I want to pray over you. I want to ask God's blessing to be upon your life. You come today. Is there one? Preacher, pray for me. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, God bless you. God bless you. Come on, is there another? Preacher, I need prayer. Whatever it is, whoever it is, come on, come on, come on. Come on, now's the time, now's the time. Now's the time, come on, come on. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Come on, my heart's cries, I want to be pure and holy. Tried and true. Hallelujah. Is there another? The altar's big enough for everybody in this room. Come on. Come on, whatever it is, whoever it is, you come today. Is there another? Preacher, pray for me. Pray for me. I need the activity of God in my life, the mercy of God on my family, on my finances, on my job, in my home, at school, whatever it is. I need the mercy of God. I need the mercy of God. I need it. I need it. Come on, say it one more time. Lord, prepare me. Hallelujah. I got issues in my life. I got pain. I got hurt in my life. And I need the mercy of God applied. I need it in my life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is there one? Come on and join us today. Come on. Come on. I'll be a lit. I want to be a sanctuary. Lord, for you. Sing it one more time. Lord, prepare me. Everybody lift your voice and say, Lord, prepare me to be a saint. And with thanksgiving.
for you.
Come on, somebody, put your hands together and open up your mouth and give God praise like he's done something in this place today. Give him praise for the glory. Give him praise for his presence. Give him praise for his help. Give him praise for his delivering power. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. I don't know what's going on here, but I know God is doing something in our midst. Hallelujah. And I didn't even stop to ask you what your details were this morning, because I don't need to know, but God knows, and God is able to be merciful in everyone's life. He's able to be loving and gracious to all of his children. Receive it today. Receive it today. Receive it today. This is the benediction. May the grace of God be upon you. May the mercy of God that is eternal in nature be upon you. May God grant you peace. May God grant you the ability to trust him at every turn, in every juncture, every hill, every valley, every mountain, every obstacle, whatever it is. May God give you the ability to trust him no matter what. Because at the end of the day, it's on his shoulders, not your shoulders. You're leaning on somebody who has the weight of the world on his shoulders. He holds the palm. He holds the world in the palm of his hand. And if he's got the whole world in his hand, he's got you in his hand. He's got your issue, your problems, your pain, your hurt, whatever it is, it's in his hand. So lean on him. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. God bless you.